Hi, I'm the Highway Groupie. In this video, we're going to be doing an in-depth review of the Synco microphone, what they call the Mini Synco. They have several models. This is the one that will mount. It's very small, similar to the Go that we find in Rode. It's very lightweight. We're going to have a very in-depth review, and if you want to jump ahead to certain facets of this review, then look at the notes below and you will find the timeline for the different parts of this review. This is truly an in-depth review. If you want to move ahead to different aspects, go right ahead. But I think if you spend the 20 minutes that this video will last, you will find that it is very complete and certainly worth the 20 minutes. At the end of the video, we're going to be doing the distance test. So let's get started. With the overall look and feel of these microphones, they seem quite rugged, fairly good construction. They're obviously very lightweight, which makes them unobtrusive. They don't have an obtrusive antenna, which can be an advantage. I'm not sure about the connectivity issue, but it can be an advantage. And if we use them without the Lavalier mics, well, they then become a completely wireless microphone, no wires at all. However, I think the use of the Lavalier microphone is a real asset with these systems. The custom-made windscreens, or dead cats, clip-on with difficulty. They have a little clip on them here, and they are a little difficult to clip into place in these things here, and they do pop off rather easily. However, there's an advantage to have something custom made, because you need that for the, if you're using the transmitters without the Lavalier microphone, you could use it for outside. I find the clips on the transmitters to be very good. I don't know if you can see them on the camera here, but they have little teeth here. If I put my finger in behind them, maybe you can see it, or the white table, there you go. So you can see them there. They have little teeth on them. That help to hold them into place, so they're very solid that way. I like these on the transmitters. What I don't like is the, if I can get this without shaking my camera too much, the receiver, the clip on that, same design, has little teeth on it, but they say that you can use this, or it doubles as in the cold shoe of your camera, that you can just open it and slide it into the cold shoe. However, I do not find that to be the case. I find that this actually is just a hair too wide for a cold shoe on a camera. So a little bit of a quibble that way. I mean, it could be trimmed down. You can use any sort of clip or whatever to trim it down. However, just to let you know that it may be just a little too wide for your camera. I don't use it in my cold shoe because it doesn't fit into the little well of my camera, but I just use the clip and clip it on to the wrist strap that is on my camera, and that holds it in place adequately. The controls are very clumsy. You have an on-off for the low gain, which will cut off anything below 180 hertz. You have the seek for the, if for whatever reason goes out of pairing, you can use the pairing button. I haven't had that problem yet. The on-off button on the transmitters, it's a little slow. Sometimes you have to hold it 2, 3, 4, 5 seconds before it actually comes on or goes off. And the buttons on the receiver, which is actually sitting on my camera, well, let me see if I can get it here. You have the on-off button here. The on-off button it also doubles as the mono stereo button. The problem is that there are no LEDs to indicate whether there's mono or stereo, or if you've changed the gain of the microphone, which is controlled on this side. It also doesn't tell you which microphone is A, which microphone is B. So that's a bit of a pain. You have to actually plug in your headphones to figure out if there's actually gain been added to the microphones, and you have to, in order to figure out if you're in mono or stereo. So that's a bit of a disadvantage. So they are a little bit clumsy. And the buttons can be a little bit unresponsive, so you just have to be a little bit patient with that. However, it does make it a little harder for you to accidentally push a button, so I suppose it has its advantages. The transmitter and the receiver, they both weigh 31 grams, even though the book says 35 grams. I came up with 31, which is very, very light. When you consider that it has its own internal battery, I'd say that that's extremely light. So certainly a 10 out of 10 in that regard. The included accessories are, shall we say, adequate. We have a little reset button here. If you can see it, a little thing to push in if you want to reset your unit. And you have the TRRS to TRRS adapter, which is very handy if you want to plug this into a smartphone, for example. And you have the TRRS cable, which is plugged into my camera at this very moment. So that's nice. You don't have the XLR adapter, which could be useful if you're giving discourses or if you need to plug this into the sound system for whatever reason. Despite the built-in microphones, they also have the two lav mics, which we can see here. And certainly without the lav mics, the sound quality would not be as good as they are. We'll see that a little later on. It would have been nice if they had supplied the windscreens for the lav mics as well. They did supply a triple USB-C cable. However, I only got one charge out of this, and after that, it just stopped working. I plugged it into different sources. It does not work anymore. One charge and gone. So that's a bit of a downer. But I did have a spare USB-C cable, so I was able to charge up the units. The carrying kit is very convenient, and it's a hardcover. It has these little cutouts, and then you can store all of your things, including pop screen. I forgot to mention the pop screen. It does have two pop screens. You can put all of your accessories in the top part here. And then the things in the bottom. If it gets kicked around a bit, these will tend to sort of float around in here, but it's not really an issue. I don't like the zipper feature of it much because it tends to be a little hard on the corners, and I'm worried that this is just going to start to rip, especially the kind of material that they're using here. I would have been much happier with, say, two, even one, for example, hasp used instead of the zipper closing. That's a personal thing. And the instruction manuals, they give you more information on how to format your camera than they do on how to format the microphones. I find that their books are very scant in information. So we can see the manual here. They give you all of the points, you know, what is what on the microphone. However, like I say, I find it very scant in information. They really don't give you enough information in here. I had to look up a number of things on the internet. So as far as the kit is concerned, I think it's reasonably complete. Give it a 6 out of 10. These units are powered with a 400 milliwatt lithium battery, and as you can see, it really helps to contribute to the compact size and weight of these units. I got between 4 and 6 hours use out of the transmitters and receiver, roughly the same time out of both. Usually you would get more time out of the receiver in a sense. However, like I say, they were roughly about the same time. Charging time is about 40 minutes. And what we see here is the camera with a dummy plug. As you can see, the noise generated is negligible. With the receiver only, that is, no microphones turned on, we can see that the difference is also negligible. With the microphone turned on, the line noise picks up about 15 to 20 decibels in the 35 to 140 hertz range. It gains only 11 decibels in the 281 range and then levels off after that to a minor gain. This will affect the bass a little, but not much more. Let's compare the line noise to the recording of the white noise. We see that the greatest loss is in the 17 to 35 range. We can ignore this, as this is sound that is more felt than it is heard. At 7240 hertz, the difference between line noise and recorded sound is about 25 to 28 decibels on average. This is not bad. For music, this would affect somewhat the bass drum or the bass guitar. At 281, it improves to around 40 decibels, which would include the lower range of a woman's voice. So a woman using these microphones for singing, if she wants to, or any sort of recording, would find that it rounds out the voice fairly well. In the 562 hertz to 4 kilohertz range, the difference is an average of 40 decibels, more or less. This is quite good for these small microphones and should give you fairly good overall sound quality. In the 9 kilohertz, the difference spikes to an average of 55 to 58 decibels. This will add more clarity, but will also add a little too much treble. Post-production can filter this out if needed, remembering that it is easier to remove than to add. Garbage in, garbage out. At 18 kilohertz, the difference averages around 40 to 43 decibels. This is very near the difference at the 281 to 4K range. Therefore, they should balance out properly. I gave this a 7 out of 10 for line noise. On the comparison of the white noise, I also gave a 7 out of 10, as the line is quite flat, with the exception of the small spike in the 9K, which we already knew about. Comparing the pink noise, we can see that we are getting a decent slope within the range of the microphone. In the 17 to 35, it falls off, of course, but that is inconsequential. And there is that small spike at 9 kilohertz. So again, I gave it a 7 out of 10. Comparing the white Gaussian noise, we notice that the overall wave pattern is decent. There is a slight spike at 140 hertz, and then it kind of loses it between 4 kilohertz and 18 kilohertz. So at this, I gave it a 6.5 out of 10. Taking a quick look at the internal microphone, so that's the microphone that's included in the transmitter. Taking a quick look, we can see that we lose depth because of poor performance in the 70 hertz to 280 hertz range. The internal microphone therefore produces a much thinner sound than we would get in the plugged-in Lavalier microphone. So if you're looking for quality of sound, you may want to bypass the internal microphone. However, it is, we could say, sufficient if you really need to do without the Lavalier microphone. As I mentioned before, the white noise for the Lavalier does quite well, with the exceptions of the 17 to 35, which don't really matter much, and the 9 kilohertz. The 9K spike adds more crispness to the sound. Some may feel that it adds too much and may wish to filter this out a bit. So let's move on to the tests that help us to see what all of this means to our ears and to the ears of our listeners. First, let's listen to Anne Murray, the way she was captured on vinyl.
Dancing through the Milky Way.
Now let's listen to how the Synco mic heard the song, that is the Lavalier Synco mic. Anne's voice is well represented here. We lose a hair in the bass, and the attack of the snare drum is slightly overstated. Both of these can be fixed in post-production if desired. So I give it a 7 out of 10. Now, Rod Beatty has a voice that sits more in the 562 Hz range. Let's listen to his portrayal of Walt Wingfield in an excerpt taken from Letters from Wingfield Farm. Very amusing. You may want to look it up.
I left the office early today and caught the train out of the city back to Larkspur. Maggie had a dinner meeting of the Women's Institute to get ready for, and she was expecting me home to do chores. It used to bother me that the whole train had to be stopped in Larkspur just to let me off. Then it carried on up to Port Petunia before going back to the city. Tonight, as soon as I stepped off, it shifted gears and chugged back the way it came. I think if I stop riding this train, we won't have one.
Now, let's see how Synco heard it.
I left the office early today and caught the train out of the city back to Larkspur. Maggie had a dinner meeting of the Women's Institute to get ready for, and she was expecting me home to do chores. It used to bother me that the whole train had to be stopped in Larkspur just to let me off. Then it carried on up to Port Petunia before going back to the city. Tonight, as soon as I stepped off, it shifted gears and chugged back the way it came. I think if I stop riding this train, we won't have one.
Rod's voice is in the acceptable range, although his S's and T's are more pronounced, and we lose a little bit of the depth of his voice. I give it a 6.5 out of 10 for, in particular, Mann's voice. For the instrumental test, we turn to Henry Mancini and his orchestra. Here is what the vinyl produced. Now let's have a listen to what the Synco heard. Although it lacks a little in the bass and has a bit too much in the attack zone, it is still easy to listen to his music, so I give it a 7 out of 10. All wireless and wired microphone systems have a small amount of latency, usually not enough to be noticed in the video. What you don't want, however, is a difference of latency between the right and left channels. This would give a tin can echo effect to the sound. The Synco mics are spot on for consistency and latency, and only a 3 decibel difference in the volume between the channels. I give them a 9 out of 10 on this point, and only because of the slight difference in volume. For line separation, well, I've seen better line separation in other systems. With Synco, we can pick up an audible crossover from one channel to the other, whether from the right to the left or from the left to the right. So I give it a 6 out of 10 here. Wind test facing wind. Microphone facing wind. Wind test microphone facing away from wind. Microphone facing away from wind. Wind test. Wind blowing across microphone. For the custom-built dead cat filters, that is the wind filters. They're very good when facing the wind. Not as good when the wind blows across, but still good enough. Perhaps combing the fur might help a little bit. I give them a 7 out of 10. For fun, I checked my stock wind filters for the Lavalier mics, and facing the wind, they are not as effective as I would like. However, at 90 or 180 degrees, they aren't bad at all. So as we can see, the supplied wind filters for the internal microphones is more effective than the stock filters that I have for the Lavalier microphones. And if you comb it a little bit, perhaps it'll work better for the transversal noise or the noise from 180 degrees. Nevertheless, both of them do a decent job. I checked the Lavalier microphones for the cardioid effect. This is the best that I have seen in a lav mic to date. In three directions, they are only plus minus 2 decibels difference. And on the fourth direction to the left, I got a 5 decibel difference from the mean 20 decibel or negative 20 decibel point. This is still less than the human ear would perceive in a difference in volume. Therefore, I give these microphones a 10 out of 10 for being omnidirectional and avoiding the cardioid effect. I did not do the same tests for the built-in microphones. Now, at this point, we're going to do the distance test of this microphone. There's sort of conflicting notes. If you look at their website, they say that on one part of the website that it's good up to 50 meters. Another part of the website says it's good up to 70 meters. We don't know. The way I have this set up is I have the integrated microphone here. I have the lav microphone or lavalier microphone set up here. Unfortunately, they only give us a windscreen for the integrated microphone. So we don't have a windscreen for the lav microphone, so I've had to take one out of my inventory and put it on here. On top of that, we have the Maono microphone. The Maono microphone, why do we have that? Well, I know that this is going to drop at some point, so I want to be able to follow where we are, and if I say something important, maybe it'll be on tape. All right. So, I'm already about 5 meters away from the camera. So let's keep on going. I'm going to turn around. The transmitter for the lav mic is behind me. The transmitter, obviously, for this mic is in front of me. So when I turn around, we're going to be losing one side. I'm recording this in stereo so that we can see exactly how it goes. And anyway, we'll talk about how to choose stereo a little later. It's not the easiest thing with this microphone. So let's start the distance test. Six, seven, eight, nine, dix, onze, douze, treize, quatorze, quinze, seize, dix-sept, dix-huit, dix-huit, dix-neuf, vingt. Je sais, j'ai dit dix-huit deux fois. Vingt-cinq. Et trente. 35, 40, 45, 50, 55, 60, 65, 70, 75, 80, 85, 90, 95, 100 meters. So I don't know who's going to be shooting a video this far away from the camera, and I'm not even sure that you can actually hear me. Anyway, we'll find out when I put this on the computer. So I'm going to start walking back. Again, now we have the lapel internal microphone is facing the receiver, whereas the lavalier transmitter is behind my back, so it has to transmit through my body. Now, as I mentioned, the windscreen is only available for, or at least it's only shipped, it's available, but it's only shipped with this kit for the integrated microphone. If you want to use the Lavalier with a windscreen, then you will have to supply your own windscreen, because their windscreen just does not fit the Lavalier. The clips on these are pretty good. They have little teeth on there that help to secure them in place. And I think you'll find that the weight of these is very good. I like the fact that they're rechargeable batteries. Some people may not like that for certain applications. Okay, so we should be definitely within range now. And there is the distance test. Hopefully it reveals something. For distance connectivity, I would have given a 3 or 4 if it weren't for the fact that they picked up better at 100 meters than at 4 meters. I would like someone from the company to contact me to explain why these are so inconsistent at short range. Right now I'm recording this at 1 meter from the receiver, actually just a little less than a meter. They're here on the table. If I had one of these in behind my body, it might start dropping on one side, I don't know. But I find that they're at close range, they're just not as consistent as they are at far range. The other day I recorded at 5 meters through some bushes. I was hard pressed to get any signal at all, even though their publicity says that I should get up to 30 meters in a non-line of sight scenario. So my rating on distance, I give it a 6 out of 10. What you can do, and what I've done when I really need to have consistent voice, is I put these on mono and I wear both microphones. That way if one drops, the other one will keep on going. So the overall rating of the Synco microphone is a 7.6 out of 10. That being said, if we count only the sound quality and reliability, we get a rating of 7.4 out of 10. I would really like to get the company to improve the consistency of connectivity. All in all, when used with the Lavalier microphones, I think the quality of sound reproduction is more than adequate. In fact, very good for this type of setup. The internal mics are not quite as good, but good enough for an interview or something of that nature. If you can get better connectivity than I did, then I think you will find that this system is a winner for the price. Hi. If you enjoyed what you saw in that video, then please click the subscribe button over here. Yeah, that one. Click the subscribe button, please. And whenever I put a video up, you will find out about it. Please.